coming in, with Guelph having had to play two games already and McGill only having played one game in 3 weeks?
Well, the advantage that McGill has, obviously, is that they haven't played the same rigorous schedule that Guelph has had. But on the other hand, you could say that Guelph has had more warm-up, and especially against tougher teams than McGill has. So it could be it could go either way this today.
Yeah, I agree that the challenge for McGill is being sharp when they've only had two close games all year. They went 10-0 in Kufla. They did play a few NCAA teams. They lost to RPI. They beat Plattsburgh State and Linden State. And we are underway with the opening faceoff. We've got Ben Van Galen, number 44 for Guelph, and Brandon McLean, number 11 for McGill, will be taking the faceoffs. They are the West and East faceoff specialist, all Canadians respectively, so it should be a great battle throughout. Guelph comes up with the first possession. Van Galen has been terrific all tournament long. Here's Jordan Critch setting it up. He's going to come back out to Taylor Brown, I was right the first time. Moves it up to Connor Duchars, their player of the game yesterday. It's number 11 for Guelph. He's going to get the ball back up top from Brett Ulbikas. Brown will go down to Brown. Sorry, Duchars down to Brown.
Guelph looks to be circling it around. McGill is playing a zone defense, but they are dropping in to cover the slides. So it is kind of a mix between a man-on-man and a zone. Very strong against a dodging team like Guelph.
Yeah, the Gryphons really like to have those cutters through the middle. Ryan Serville will set up down. He's actually up above the crease line right now, but there he goes back behind the net. Here's a shot from Jordan Critch. That's going to be Guelph ball as it's stopped by Riley McGillis, the all-Canadian goaltender. And Guelph loves to get those cutters. Watch for Curtis Knight, number 9, cutting through the slot, and he has been very dangerous throughout the weekend.
McGill needs to work on that defense there. Guelph had a very good chance there. It was a great slide by Paul Ricosi, but unfortunately he still got a shot off, and it was a good chance for the Guelph Gryphons.
Or fortunately from the perspective of Guelph, of course. There's Curtis Knight coming over to cover on Emil Sison-Lawless. Sison-Lawless with the big goal yesterday for McGill. McGill, of course, winning handily 15-6 against Queens yesterday. Guelph, a bit of a surprise, taking out Brock 14-9. Not a shock that Guelph beat Brock, as they were very close in their second game of the season this year. Brock winning by just one goal, 13-12. But I don't think anyone expected Guelph to come out and run out to a five-goal win yesterday over Brock. McGill with the ball, their first extended possession. Kevin Donovan will flip it back up top. Eric Sipperly. Sorry, that is... Anders Biela has the ball. McGill with a very exotic roster. A lot of Americans. They've got some players from all over the country, both Canada and the States. Biela, Wisconsin. And he will score the first goal of the game. Seemed to fool Jeremy Snyder. Snyder, who was terrific yesterday, I think would probably like to have that one back. It was just a simple little high-to-high shot that snuck by him.
That's a very American move, Anders Biela being from Wisconsin. The dodge to your offhand and the outside shot. That's a move you'll very rarely see in Canada. It's becoming more popular now, while at the same time more of the inside game is becoming more popular in Canada. In America, sorry.
So 1-0 from McGill very quickly. And the one thing that you've got to look at for Guelph is they have played three games. This is their third game in 3 days. And I think it'll be important for them to stay close, not get behind early, because it's easy to come out and not have your A game when you are going up against the defending champions. We're going to have a possession call. It's going to go towards Guelph. Ben Van Galen hustling off the field along with Garrett Daly. And Guelph will set up. Now the officials are going to have a chat and decide they want to make sure they've got this right. They are going to confirm that it is Guelph ball. Connor Duchars. I didn't realize how tall Connor Duchars is until I interviewed him after the game yesterday. He's about 6'5 or 6'6, and I'm 6'9, so it was a very comfortable interview. I love interviewing the big guys, but terrific game yesterday. A lot of their players playing very well, and they've really had a chance to find their game over the last couple of days, of course, playing Friday against Bishops, and a lot of people considered that an upset as the number 3 seed from the West.
Well, especially considering Bishops is really the only Kufla team that gave McGill a competition during the regular season.
Yeah, Bishops just losing to McGill by 2 goals in one game, one the other. There's a quick shot, a goal! There's the cutter we talked about. Guelph loving to cut down. Ryan Serville from behind the net hitting the cutter. I believe that was Brett Ulbikas getting the first goal. It was ubiquitous for Guelph, and what a start for the Gryphons. That's great for them to tie it up. They definitely didn't want to fall behind, and coming back and tying it up, big move for them.
I actually played with Brettel because when I was growing up, and that is his favorite move, just the strong dodge. He's a very strong player, cuts right through the middle or down the side and takes a low shot. It's a personal favorite of his.
And a nice pass by Ryan Treville, who's been playing very well throughout the tournament. He scored 5 goals in the first game, 4 again yesterday. Certainly a big threat anytime he's got the ball. And now we have Van Galen called for a possession foul off the faceoff procedure. So it's McGill ball, and they're going to try and take the lead back. Comes over on the near side. That's Reese Burnell. McGill trying to get everybody a touch to start out. Brandon McLean back to Burnell. Alex Rohrbach, one of the captains behind the net. He loves to set up back there. He'll come back to Burnell. Lots of movement so far, not really getting anyone into the slot. They do have one of their other captains, Nolan Prinzen, is set up on top of the crease. Here's a dodge by Taylor Sipperly. He loses it. Nice work by Van Galen. They're going to call an obstruction foul, a push from behind. It'll be McGill ball. Watch for Van Galen playing really tough defense. Right now he's locked up on Kevin Donovan, who's like another coach on the field for this McGill team and such a talented player coming from Lehigh University in the States, where he did a 4-year degree and is up here doing some master's work, I understand. Burnell with the ball again. He's just going to go for a bit of a trot.
Burnell has actually made the transition to attack this year. He was a very strong midfielder specializing in defense last year. He transitioned to attack this year and has flourished there.
Sipperly driving to the net, turns and tries to flip one low behind the back. McGill, a nice hustle there, Rohrbach. He gets back there all the time to get those second chance possessions on the shot. He's being watched by Daly. There's the pass and a goal. That's a beautiful pass by Rohrbach. And you talked about the transition that Burnell's made to the attack, and yeah, he showed you there that he's got some stick skills. That's a great quick release.
Burnell is a BC boy, and he just appears to be working great with Alex Rohrbach. They've got some great chemistry going on.
Burnell didn't actually see that much field time yesterday, but he's out here now and certainly earning some more with that one. We'll see how this faceoff goes. Remember the last one, Van Galen called for procedure. But these two they know that they're up against some of respectively, the top guy in the other division, so they're really battling it out. McLean almost pulled that up, but Van Galen managed to get a bit of it. Now we've got a procedure call. A kick, and it's going to be McGill possession. So McLean so far getting the better of the draws. That's his third win out of the 4 taken so far. 2-1 for the McGill Redmen. I am Stephen Stamp with Ben Follows. Thanks for being with us here on this SSN Canada streaming of the Gataway Cup Championship 2013. It's been a great weekend in lacrosse, and this by far the best weather we've had. It's sunny, it's a little over freezing, but it's a nice day. And the Badgers, as they came, or the Gryphons, as they came into the stadium today, walked through the tunnel, came out and started screaming about what a beautiful day for lacrosse it is.
Maybe a bit warmer would be perfect, but it's pretty flawless right now.
It's November.
Yeah.
There's a nice little spin move and the shot and the goal. What a play. Just a brilliant possession by Emil Sasson-Lawless. And some of the not-so-familiar names for McGill stepping up so far. Sorry. That was actually Leland DeLangley, number 1, getting it. So DeLangley is one of the leading scorers for him, so one of the usual suspects. But, we've barely even seen Connor Goodwin being involved in the play. He was their player of the game yesterday with 4 goals and 2 assists, and, you know, one of the best players in Kufla. And Kevin Donovan, the one thing about Kevin Donovan, number 66 for McGill, keep your eyes on him. He may not stand out all the time, but he is always playing a key role for them in the flow of the game, in what's going on out there, directing everyone. But Guelph will take possession on this one.
Generally, when you're speaking about Donovan, you've got to keep in mind that he is basically the quarterback of the defense. He's coordinating the offense.
Yeah.
Sorry.
It's okay.
He's coordinating the offense. He's been a huge help in their offense this year, bringing in all the strategies and skills he's learned from Lehigh. And obviously, he's been a huge addition to them. putting up massive points during the regular season.
Yeah, 28 goals and 9 assists. He can really finish. The 9 assists, a bit deceptive because he is a good setup man. Ball moving around for the Gryphons. Cervilla gets it out to the top. Comes back to Duchars. He's going to take a bit of a dodge here. Passes it back to Cervilla with the skip pass. He's coming out. Covered nicely there by Hayden Nix. The shot and the goal! Guelph comes right back, doing exactly what they need to do. That was Ryan Cerville sliding out from behind, and I'll tell you, Cerville, he's tough to stop with that big body and the talented stick.
It's very rare that you see someone beat Hayden Nix that way. Hayden Nix, probably one of the most improved players of the last year on the McGill roster, made the All-Canada team, and has played almost flawlessly this weekend. That's one of the first slip-ups I've seen from him.
He's been very good. He was we picked the the players of the game and the defensive players, and in McGill's first game, Nix was right there in the mix for top defender of the game. We wound up going with one of his teammates, with Quentin Bradley, who was just outstanding yesterday. But he's a terrific player.
Quentin Bradley is actually just won the loose ball on the faceoff. That's a specialty of his. He's a master on the draw. Put him on the draw and he'll win the loose ball 9 times out of 10.
Here comes McGill setting up, trying to get that goal back. A little over 9 minutes left here in the first quarter of what is already shaping up to be a terrific Bagataway Cup final. Both teams, I mean, these are two solid, they are solid defensively. McGill certainly with better defensive numbers over the year. We talked off the air before the game about how they don't face quite the same level of competition as Guelph does in the West. Guelph gave up some more goals, but both these teams can score. Holding the other team off the score sheet is going to be at a premium. Here's a dodge and a drive by Biela. Biela taking a big role today. He's going to go back up top. That's Taylor Sipperly. The Sipperly brothers, number 9, Taylor, number 6, Eric. You'll see them both out there. Brandon McLean trying to head to the net. Takes a shot that's a little bit wide, and he has ridden to the ground. Nice job by Garrett Daly to drive him down.
Brandon McLean is a player who uses his body to get to the front of the net. It's important that Guelph needs to shut him down, make sure a defender who can take him is on him if they want to shut him down.
Yeah, you want to. He's one of those guys you want to make sure you've got a long pole on. Of course, there's about 5 or 6 of them from McGill. Here's a drive by Sipperly and a goal. Switching hands, getting back to his dominant right hand and sneaking it home. That's just a great individual effort by Sipperly.
And you'll see that from Sipperly all day long. He's great at those individual drives. He's extremely creative with the stick. He had the backwards shovel that missed the net a minute or two ago. And don't be surprised if he scores a few goals today.
Yeah, he got a couple yesterday and looked very good doing it. And I'll tell you, we've been expecting some high-scoring games. We thought, yesterday we thought the Guelph versus Brock game might really explode the scoreboard a bit, as both teams can really score. But it really didn't happen that much. But here we've got 6 goals in the first 12 and a half minutes of this first quarter. Certainly looks like we might be in for a bit more of what we'd expected with the two high potency offenses. That ball come up with by McGill. Aussie Long, who's a tremendous defender and one of the captains of this club, he'll pass the ball off, and McGill sets up the O again with a 4-2 lead.
Talking about the lack of scoring in the previous game, a great example of that was the third quarter between Guelph and Brock yesterday, where the first goal was scored 13 minutes into the quarter. That game ended up being 14-9 due to quite a bit of scoring in the fourth quarter, but for a while there, both defenses were playing shutdown.
They
and
were.
No one could get through.
Yeah, and Guelph scored 7 goals in the fourth quarter, largely because Brock was in a position where they had to take some risks. They really had to get out and take some chances, and Guelph just made them pay for it. So a bit of an aberration there as Brock was behind. But, yeah, there have been some great defense. You can see right now McGill really spreading the offense out. Nobody heading towards the slot. Eventually, looks like Leland DeLangley is going to slide his way in. Now they're getting closer. Kevin Donovan in the background just sneaking in, directing some traffic. Here comes a drive by Connor Goodwin. Goodwin, a great shooter. Nice arm save there by Jeremy Snyder. Snyder was lights out yesterday. Certainly one of the best players on the field yesterday evening.
Keep an eye on the Guelph defense. The Guelph defense is playing a much more man-on-man game than the McGill team is, which can be extremely strong, but it's also possible to beat. So Guelph has to be very easy that they don't just isolate their top players, such as Sipperly or Rohrbach, and allow them to dodge and go for the net themselves.
Again, the problem, of course, with facing McGill, they have so many players, so many potent offensive players. So does Guelph, of course. Each team with four guys who score a bunch in, as All-Canadians. Four All-Canadian selections from Guelph, and Ryan Serville, Jordan Critch, Curtis Knight, and Connor Duchars, all that will play a lot up in the offensive zone. Kevin Donovan, Connor Goodwin, Alex Rohrbach, and Brandon McLean, all All-Canadians for McGill, and Leland DeLangley, an honorable mention. So we've got a lot of talented players. Of course, McGill also had a few defensive players as All-Canadians. David Nedelko for Guelph was an honorable mention All-Canadian. He was the top defender in the game yesterday. Guelph moving the ball around in the back. Jordan Critch has one bounce by him, and Serville tried to get it over to him. And Ryan Serville puts his hands on his head after that one goes out of bounds, handing it over. And both teams need to be very careful not to just give away possessions like that pass there. It's going to be a nice methodical clear here for Riley McGillis, the All-Canadian goalie out of Peterborough, Ontario, for McGill. Nice little slip move. What a dodge by Brandon McLean to get through a pair of Guelph defenders and get the ball up into the offensive zone. Prinzen goes down to Burnell. Rohrbach taking his time, surveying the field, gives it over to Donovan. Ball comes up to the top. Back around here to Sipperly. Sipperly is being run wide. Good positioning by Curtis Knight. You see Curtis Knight, who's one of the leading scorers for this Guelph team. Oh, the ball, the player almost pushed out there to the back. But here McGill gets a dodge towards the net. The shot, nice save. Stopping Donovan. Ball comes over on the near side to Matthew Lyons. He's going to just flip it back to Snyder. Pass over on the far side for Guelph. The long pole pass.
Guelph's defense is doing a great job moving it up the field now, spreading out the McGill offense. They have an extra player in the defensive end due to the goalie being back there, and they are using it to their advantage to get the ball out of their own zone.
Yeah, and both these teams are very good at taking advantage when something opens up. McGill, I think, even especially so. Riley McGill is such a good passer, their goalie. When he makes a save, he is so quick to get the ball out of his stick into the open man that oftentimes the opposition doesn't even get a chance to set the ride up. Double team on Duchars. He's working to hang on to the ball. It's on the ground. It's going to be scooped up, it looks like, by Rufus Frost. It's actually Hayden Nix coming up with it eventually. Nix heading up the field. He's going to have to come back. Riley McGillis directs where to pass it since he was covered by Ryan Serville on the ride. And another pretty easy one. Dan Williams comes out. He had a big game, a big second half yesterday. He's going to throw it back and head off the field, get some offensive personnel out.
Duchars is a very strong dodger. That's a rare double team for him. I have to doubt that he saw the second guy coming or else he would have passed it.
Yeah, he's done a nice job. Actually, both of these teams did exemplary jobs yesterday during their games of not overhandling the ball. A couple of times maybe with McGill, they may have held on a bit too long. But for the most part, I think both these teams are very good at keeping the ball hot, keeping it going so they don't run into that double-team trouble and don't really allow the slides to come over and have a huge impact. Burnell back up top. Biela. And very nice to see a lot of the parents of these McGill players are here in Montreal. There's a loge up on the level that we're broadcasting from where there's all kinds of parents set up enjoying the game. And because it's so nice, they actually have the windows wide open and get to hear what's going on as well as seeing it. It's a dodge by Biela. He's going to spin. Covered by Knight, but he gets by him, not able to get a shot off. Knight recovers well. As mentioning, Knight is one of their offensive stars, but he also plays some very solid defense for them, a great all-around midfielder.
Yeah, that was a great recovery by number 22 on Queens, on Guelph there, where Anders Biela pulled a great swim move on him, and he recovered beautifully, took out the shot, and prevented a scoring opportunity for Biela.
That's Brandon Pitts, is number 22 for Guelph. He's the short stick defender. Oh, and the ball just dropped by Burnell, but it's picked up. Recovered by Biela. He gets a shot. Just a nice save there by Snyder. Just got a little piece of it. Ball goes in behind. McGill's going to recover. Now it's going to roll out the back, and Guelph has the ball. McGill trying to say that went out off a Guelph player, but I guess Rohrbach's contending that he didn't touch the ball, but he was all over it, and it definitely looked like it went off of him. Van Galen will just toss it up to Curtis Knight. Guelph will have a pretty easy clear here as they get it up to Matthew Lyons. Lyons having a good weekend for the Gryphons. The whole team has played so well for them to get through Bishops and Brock, both considered upsets. Although you watch the team play, and they certainly believe in themselves. Critch is stripped. Great play there.
Yeah, Guelph is definitely Hoffman. Playing on the top of their game. They finished 9-3 during the regular season, and behind both Brock and
Western.
Yeah, and Western. But they've clearly just improved dramatically. I don't know if it's just this weekend or whether the coach did something, but they are playing at an entirely different level, and that is phenomenal.
Yeah, no, that's the end of the first quarter. It is 4-2 for the McGill Redmen. That is a great first quarter of McCataway Cup action. Excellent lacrosse. We wondered coming out, we talked a little before, you know, at the opening of the broadcast about, will Guelph be a bit tired after playing two games in 2 days? Will they, after the emotional wins over Bishops, who you mentioned one of the top teams for several years here, and then over their big rival Brock, and of course for McGill not having faced too much stiff competition this year, would they be a little flat? But both teams really coming out and playing quite sharp. I think there's maybe two drop passes the entire quarter.
Yeah, all the passes are really crisp, and both teams are extremely focused. They want this. They want this. They are focused, and they are playing at the top of their game, and it'll just come down to whoever wants it more.
So what do what do the Gryphons need to do, Ben? I'm Stephen Stamp with Ben Follows bringing you this game. And what do the Gryphons need to do to get back into this and make sure that McGill isn't able to pull away? Because McGill's a tough team to come back on when they do get a lead.
I think the most important thing to do for the Guelph Gryphons is to absolutely shut down defensively. Mm-hmm. They've been almost flawless, but those two or three mistakes they've made, McGill has capitalized on. And McGill is that sort of team. If the Gryphons want to come back, they need to shut down and give McGill as few opportunities as possible.
I believe, actually, it looks like we did have a timeout. The clock is on the field, so it wasn't the end of the quarter. That was just a timeout for McGill setting up this final possession. And there, we just talked about how sharp it's been. That pass was a little low. Donovan not able to handle it. It was Connor Goodwin trying to connect, and that will do it for the end of the first quarter now. So everything we said still stands for the end of the first quarter, and certainly an exciting game so far. You can see the shadows on our broadcast right kind of creeping in now as the sun is gradually making its way over, and that could cool things down a little bit, but this is perfect situations. Now, the referee's conducting a stick check from each team, and illegal sticks have been a big story this weekend, especially in the Queens over Western game where they were the main story.
I think Western had... In particular, Western started the second half with 6 minutes worth of stick penalties, which is just detrimental to your team.
Well, luckily, and Patrick McCrory was ejected for both having the illegal stick and for touching the head. Mm-hmm. He punched the head before he gave his stick away, so he gets 3 minutes for that, and he's ejected from the game.
And he's a very strong player for them, so that could be a huge thing. That was a huge story in that game and obviously helped Queens a lot, considering I don't know the exact numbers, but Western must have had 15, 18 minutes of stick penalties throughout that game.
Well, they certainly were not very happy about it, and it was trying to see whose stick it was that was checked. Looks like Brandon Pitt's getting his stick back. They are random checks, of course, and his stick has been returned. We haven't seen any flags, so both sticks appear to be okay. It was Brandon McLean checked for the McGill Redmen, and I would imagine both coaches chatted with their players. I saw a few players in pregame taking their sticks, putting a ball in, and going through the checks, making sure the ball was coming out, and making sure their sticks were legal. And nobody wants to get caught with an illegal stick. That makes a big difference in the Gadway Cup final.
Both these teams were watching the Queens Western game, so they would be very familiar with the fact that the refs are taking no nonsense with the sticks. If it is even the tiniest bit illegal, you're getting a 3-minute penalty, and that is not helpful in a championship game.
Oh, it's so big. I mean, it's a non-releasable penalty. You are short for those 3 minutes unless the other team takes a penalty. And I don't think either of these teams can afford that, because we've talked about these being, you know, among the most potent offenses in all of Kufla. You know, both these teams can hurt you in a hurry.
Oh yeah, with an extra man, you'll see it on fast breaks, I guarantee. But if you have an extra man for 3 minutes, both these teams are going to capitalize that with a few goals.
Nice job there by Guelph to come up with that one. Curtis Knight, who's just a loose ball hound, both in box and in field lacrosse, goes in and grabs that one. Knight, of course, playing for the Edmonton Rush of the National Lacrosse League. Number nine there with the ball in his stick, passing it over to Brett Ulbicus. I was saying Ulbicus.
It's
Ulbicus. I was saying Ulbicus, but it's Ulbicus. You know him better than I do, so I'm going to go with your pronunciation. Comes to Treville, back out tonight. Ulbicus throws it over to Duchars. Looks like he's going to go for a bit of a run, trying to get past Aussie Long. Here comes Knight. Serville working his way out. The spin, the shot, the goal. Serville has been just about unstoppable this weekend when he rolls out from below the net, and he gets another one. He just is so strong with his body and with his foot position. He's just so sturdy on his feet, and he's solid with the stick. He can get the shot off as he's being hit.
What Nick was defending there was that he was expecting Knight to come around the top, whereas Knight actually spun back just to free up his arms and took the shot without actually beating the defender, which basically just gave Knight a good position for a shot, and Nix helped him with the screen.
Sorry, was that Knight? I thought it was Serville that got that one.
Oh, that might be my mistake.
No problem. I believe it was number three, Ryan Serville, coming out from behind the net again. That'd be his second of the game. And I'll tell you, he has been strong throughout. He uses that big body to just work his way out. And he's scored a lot of goals on spin moves as he comes out, just gets his back onto his defender, and does a good job of holding the stick out away from his body. Knight throws it back to Serville. He'll go over to Critch on the far side. Jordan Critch, a Buffalo Bandit during the winter. Here's Ulbicus. Oh, what a nice pass to Knight. Bounces it into the top corner. We have a tie game. What a pass. What a shot.
Great pass by Ulbicus. He dodged, drew the slide, and that opened up Curtis Knight right in the middle. Curtis Knight had 42 points in 12 games over the regular season, so he is not gonna miss that if you give him a shot right in the middle.
No, Curtis Knight, a 28-goal scorer, and as I've pointed out a couple times over the weekend, for anyone who hasn't heard us before, he was the MVP of the Minto Cup 2 years ago, in 2011, when he was on the Whitby Warriors with Mark Matthews. And when you're playing with Mark Matthews and you win the MVP award as a third-year junior with a couple years left to play, you've really accomplished something, because Matthews is one of the great players in the game, both in box and field lacrosse. McLean and Van Galen both directing their players where they want them to be for this faceoff. Kevin Donovan lining up beside Curtis Knight. That's a whole lot of lacrosse talent right there around the 55-yard line. They're waiting for the official command.
I don't believe McGill has won a faceoff yet this half, so they need to step that up. A very rare string of losses for Brandon McLean.
And Van Galen draws this one out, and it's going to go straight to Knight. A great draw again by Van Galen. He does so much. He's a LSM and faceoff specialist All-Canadian in the West. And he was also an honorable mention defender. So that's a lot of awards for him, and you can see why today already, as he has done a tremendous job. And he always draws one of the opposition's top offensive threats. He is staying with Kevin Donovan in this game. Here's Duchars running towards the net, saved by Riley McGillis. McGillis is going to have to dodge out of his crease and take a look around. Guelph doing a great job of very quickly picking up all the McGill players and making it harder for McGillis to find his outlet man, but he does on the far side.
Duchars has got to work on his shot placement there. If you're going to take a shot from there, you have to be putting it low or harden over the goalie stick. That was too easy a save for Riley McGillis if you're going to take that shot, because you will lose the ball, and you see that now McGill has the possession.
Yeah, if you're going to go high to high from in close, you better make sure it's hardened into the corner, like you said, and might want to try bouncing it down. Of course, one thing that if they've scouted this McGill team, Riley McGillis is so good on low shots. He's so quick with his stick that maybe they're thinking the high shot's going to work out better, but you got to change it up. Of course, Duchars had a great game yesterday, scored on a couple of dodges like that. I think he just missed his target on that one.
Yeah.
Here's Rohrbach sliding behind the net. He's going to go move the ball over to Donovan on the far side. That's Donovan. A little spin move.
Donovan, a strong dodger, trying to get his hands free.
Look at that defensive work by Ben Van Galen, though. Great footwork. Gets a little help there from Curtis Knight. Knight now trying to dislodge the ball. He does. Doesn't realize it's free, though, so it's scooped up by McLean. Back to Donovan. This is a great battle. There's a hard shot by Donovan, but Rohrbach once again in position. to get that to get the possession again for McGill. Rohrbach is so good, so aware of when a shot is coming and getting himself in position.
Rohrbach's strength comes from his field awareness. He's always aware of exactly what's going on around him, and he uses that to his advantage. And there's Donovan getting his hands free.
Kevin Donovan, even with the sound defense there by Van Galen, Donovan gets free and rips that one home. But Donovan, a big, strong man, and able to just use his off arm legally while he still had it on the stick to just create a bit of space for himself, and he rips it past Jeremy Snyder. McGill is back in the lead.
Kevin Donovan had 28 goals this year in just 8 games, so he's clearly a very lethal scorer, and that shot that you just saw, the cannon, is exactly why.
And on the move, he likes to spot up and shoot, but he showed there he can shoot on the run as well. A great moving shot, and there is a win. It's actually
Jordan Sanford wins that draw, but then he gets stripped by a Guelph player.
It was either Garrett Daly or Ben Van Galen that knocked that one free. I believe it was Daly getting his stick on stick. But McGill comes up with the ball. Riley McGillis makes a nice pass just to midfield. Anders Biela moves it down to the back. That's Taylor Sipperly with the ball. Haven't actually seen much of Eric Sipperly today. Not sure if he tweaked something yesterday or if they're just going with some different matchups today. They've got so much depth on this club that they can sub guys in and out and not miss a beat. Actually, it's Eric Sipperly with the ball now on the far side.
Yes, he is.
Giving it over to his brother Taylor, so I'll rescind the comment that we haven't seen him yet. Comes back over to Donovan. Van Galen keeping a close eye on him.
Something to watch for is that if the Guelph players are putting their top defenders like Van Galen on the McGill Stars, they may take players like Donovan off to put another attackman on and then bring Donovan in from the midfield.
The other thing they've done, and you can see it, there's a nice save by Snyder on the hard shot, but it's picked up by Sipperly. The other thing you'll see is Kevin Donovan just clearing out of the way a bit and letting some others set up on top of the crease, and that will draw Van Galen out with him and give the others a chance to do it, and they recognize there's a lot of talent. That pass gets away, and it's going to roll just out of bounds. Will be Guelph ball, and that's, I think, only about the second time we've seen McGill give up a possession with a faulty pass or reception. Nice dodge there by Calvin Holland to get the ball up. He's looking for the pass. Oh, and doesn't quite connect. Ulbicus was, I think, a little bit over-eager to shoot, but a big hit there by Van Galen. It's play on. They're going to call. They were going to call an obstruction foul, but they play possession. Now it's set down. We have an illegal screen called on McGill, so Guelph gets the ball back. We're way up above the stadium here. It's a great view, but you can actually hear that call by the official, even with our headsets on. And it's a nice crowd over in the far side of the stadium, checking out this Gataway Cup final on a beautiful fall afternoon. I'm Steven Stamp with Ben Follows. Thank you so much for being with us here. There's a nice little roll pass by Cooper Catt over to his goalie, Jeremy Snyder. Some pressure by Sipperly. That's Eric Sipperly. So they throw it to the far side. Matt Lyons just stopping it before it gets out of bounds. He has to pick it up. Now McGill's got some pressure on. No timed clear in Kufla. They go by FIL rules primarily. So there's the pass back to Snyder. So Guelph has lots of time. Snyder will just move up slowly.
Guelph again using their extra player in the defensive zone to move the ball up the field.
Now I didn't catch what that call was for, but it's going to be McGill possession. Some kind of procedure call. We're going to have some changes as McGill gets our offensive personnel back out. Here's Donovan trying to drive past Van Galen. This is a great matchup to watch all day. Two of the very best players in this league. Van Galen will go right around the net. Obviously a man-on-man as he is sticking with Kevin Donovan, trying to take him out of the game as much as possible. Nice fake pass. Van Galen, great job to pick Donovan up again. Donovan trying to work his way through. It's down on the ground, and that should be... Oh, it's going to be Guelph possession. I thought they might call Van Galen for the push after the ball was loose, but it was still within 9 feet. So here comes Curtis Knight. Great speed to head up the field. Switches hands. Oh, what a save by Riley McGillis.
And that was almost a great end-to-end rush by Curtis Knight.
Knight scored one yesterday where he went 120 yards running around, got in, stripped the ball in his own end, went all the way up the field, dodged, used his speed to get by a few defenders, and then wound up going, just taking a shot and scoring. There's a shot by Critch. That one turned aside.
That end-to-end rush by Curtis Knight is a great example of just how strong of a two-way player he is. He can take the ball in the defensive end and go down and score all by himself.
And he'll often create the turnover himself in the defensive zone to get the whole thing started. Here's Crit handing the ball off to Serville. Serville working his way out, trying to get past Hayden Nix. Nix gets some help.
And Nix strips him, and Riley McGillis gets the loose ball.
Bradley Hoffman came over to help, and Nix used that help to take advantage and get the strip. Nix, you mentioned he's been beat a couple of times, but boy, he's playing some pretty solid D on Serville. Serville would be, I guess, Guelph's kind of equivalent to Kevin Donovan in terms of the big body with the solid shot. I think Donovan probably a bit harder and better of a shooter, but Serville very good at dodging past players and getting himself in position for the close shots to just tap home. McLean sending up top. Connor Goodwin, number 14, just on the near side of your screen, has been pretty quiet today. He had a great game yesterday. We'll see if he gets things going. He's got the
It looks like they're playing Connor Goodwin pretty close, although he broke away there.
Yeah, he just headed up to midfield. Now he's passing it back out high. The shot by DeLangley. What a play. DeLangley coming open. Connor Goodwin made a great dodge down the slot, took the ball around behind the net and fired it out to DeLangley, and there was a lot of traffic in front. He just ripped it past.
That was a great example of changing the elevation on the shot. He's going low to high, goalie can't predict that.
DeLangley with his second goal of the day on a great pass from Goodwin. It's 6-4 for McGill. They've re-established the two-goal lead they enjoyed at the end of the first quarter when it was 4-2. We've got 8 minutes left in the half. I'm Stephen Stamp with Ben Follows. We'll see McLean back in for McGill, see if he can win a draw in this quarter. But it's Van Galen, it looks like, pulling it out. They actually both left the ball sitting there, pulled away, and Van Galen was able to spin around first. Nice strip, but it pounces right out to Garrett Daly. A bit of a tough break for McGill as they worked hard on that double team to knock the ball free and couldn't come up with possession from it. Taylor Brown will take the ball down behind the net. He's got Serville on the far side. He's going to give it to him now. Nix is out on him.
Both teams seem to be playing very carefully with their sticks since there have been no penalties called yet this game.
But it's not that they're not playing tough. I mean, they are playing tough, solid defense, but just being very aware of getting stick on stick.
They're playing very smart. They don't want to get any penalties to negatively impact their team in any way.
This is a great lacrosse game, I'll tell you. I mean, we've had some excellent lacrosse this weekend, but for overall skill level and just the level of play, I think this is the best we've seen. And just as I say that, we have a ball thrown away, but what a battle. But that's going to be offside as the Guelph player was shoved over the line. Nice alertness by Alex Rohrbach to give Cooper Catt the shove over the line. Cooper Catt was saying that he was pushed from behind, which, yeah, you could make that argument. But I think it'd have to be a bit more obvious to make the first call of the game on that one. The refs are pretty much staying out of the way, not overly imposing themselves on this game, making the calls when they need to be made. I don't think either team will be overly upset with the calls. I mean, you're never going to agree with all the calls, obviously. But there has been some controversy about some of the calls made this weekend.
Yeah. Well, especially in a game, like, for example, we talked about the Western Queens game, where there's just so much passion and just teams getting really heated. The refs need to keep that under control.
Here comes Sipperly going to the net, the save.
Oh.
That one almost snuck by. It caught the hip, it looked like, of Jeremy Snyder. Sipperly wasn't able to get a lot on it. He had to cross over to get any kind of an angle at the net, and Snyder managed to stop. Now Van Galen's going to take his time. He'll now flip it over to Snyder, as he's forced by Alex Rohrbach. Nobody open for Guelph right now, so Snyder will just take his time, walk up the field. They do have the, as you mentioned, the numbers advantage in their own zone, so they'll take their time. It's going to be a long pole pass, probably. There it is. There's Matt Lyons heading up over midfield. Kevin Donovan runs right off the field as he was chasing him down. That ball is down on the ground. Is it going to roll out? Nice work there by Paul Ricosi to shield that ball, but it looks like they're going to say it went off of him, as it will be Guelph possession. They come up to Duchars. Duchars over to Knight. Knight being watched by Williams. Guelph taking their time, setting things up. not trying to venture towards the middle of the field at this point. Let's move it around. Here comes Ulpicus. Back over to Knight, and you'll see that a lot. For those of you who haven't seen Guelph play, they will have Knight cross over to that side on his offside, and Ulpicus over on the left side, with the left-hand side, we usually have the right-hand shooters. And they seem to like the angles that it creates for them, having them kind of inverted. This is Duchars now heading down. Speaking of inversions, he's heading down below the goal line, and Ryan Serville has come up to about the 25-yard line. He'll be probably cutting soon to look for a pass, but instead they try and hit Knight or Brown on top of the crease. It's Knight that picks up the ground ball, maintains possession. Good effort. They just couldn't quite connect with the pass. Here's Knight. What a dodge, but he loses it now, stripped. Nice job by Ricozzi. We're going to have an illegal push. And it's going to be Guelph ball once again. So just when it looked like McGill had it back, now it comes out to Brown. He's going to head down to Jordan Critch, and they'll reset the offense. To Serville, who's back behind the net, back up to Duchars.
McGill is playing some great defense right now. They're shutting down any opportunities that Guelph has made. And Guelph is, as a result, making some mistakes.
Yeah, I mean, the Guelph loves to get to the middle of the field there and get those slot shots, but McGill is so quick at closing on them and making it hard to collect the passes in traffic, doing a great job of it. Great team defense. Ricozzi has been excellent for them, number 21, and, of course, Ozzie Long, number 2, the short stick. And there's a shot and a goal, though, by Ulbicus. He just ran off his man, and just as we're praising McGill, they actually had a bit of a missed assignment there.
And as you were saying before, with Ulbicus going on his offside, you can see that it allowed him to get his arms free on the outside and take a shot going down the lane.
Great point. We're coming into the final 3 minutes of the first half. 6-5 for McGill. What a game this is. I am having a blast watching it. I hope you guys are enjoying it as much as we are. I'm Stephen Stamp with Ben Follows. Remember, you can keep up with all the Kufla news at the Kufla website, kufla.ca. That's C-U-F-L-A.ca. Stands, of course, for Canadian University Field Lacrosse Association. That is Jordan Sanford in for the faceoff. He's doing a pretty good job as the backup faceoff man. But it's going to be Guelph ball as we had a push in the back on that ground ball. Garrett Daly staying out for to get the offense started. He'll most likely pass it off and head for the bench shortly. He's actually going to run the ball over, give it off to Duchars and head off. He'll take his time. Guelph setting up. Duchars, the big man, with the ball still in his stick. He's being watched by, looks like Bo Hosking playing some defense back there. Guelph has all their personnel out now, so they're going to start moving in. Taylor Brown gives it over to Ulbicus.
McGill has their long stick midi, Quinton Bradley, covering Duchars.
Quinton Bradley has had a terrific tournament in terms of his game yesterday. He was the defensive player of the game. Played some great defense and had a really nice run up the field as well. Here's Critch trying to work his way up from behind, but Bradley Hoffman keeping him in the back. There's a shot and a goal. Ryan Serville is on fire once again, his third of the game. And I'll tell you, he is just a load for them to cover. They might have to... Well, they have. I was going to say they might have to try double covering him, but they've been trying to double team him, and he's still fighting his way through.
Well, the problem, as we mentioned before, is that if you were to double team Serville, you're leaving one of their other great players open.
Yeah. Anytime you come down on Serville, you'll have Ulbicus or Curtis Knight, the midfielders, are going to slide into the high slot ready for a pass, and these guys work so well with each other. They know where each other are. We are back to 6-6 into the final minute of the first half. Couldn't ask for much more from a Bagatoway Cup championship game. And we're going to have a timeout to McGill as they will set up for a play. We're not into the final 30 seconds yet. The clock has not come onto the field. And beautiful afternoon, a great game of lacrosse. And it's like the level of play has just gradually stepped up throughout the weekend.
Oh, yeah. These guys are slowly realizing just how well they're going to have to play in order to win this championship. And they are stepping up to the plate. Another thing to mention on that goal is that Ryan Serville now has a hat trick. Every goal has been a different dodge. Like,
that's a good point.
A lot of players have one or two moves that they're really good at. Ryan Serville has scored on three different moves: a roll inside, a roll outside, and a roll question mark dodge, and just a roll outside and a shot. And for a defenseman, any defenseman, no matter how good they are,
that is hard to defend because you have no idea what they're going to do.
Yeah, when a player, like you said, a lot of players have their move, their go-to move that they'll use over and over. But Serville just seems to have that knack for knowing exactly where his defender is, feeling the body on him and knowing which way to go. And it doesn't seem to matter to him which way he has to go. Now, the one thing, I mean, we haven't yet seen him switch hands to go from the left side. The reason, he doesn't need to. When you've got that many tricks in your bag, you don't have to switch hands when you can get yourself open on your strong hand.
Well, another thing that Serville is doing that all attackmen should try to do is that you're going into the dodge not knowing what you're doing. You're feeling it out based on how the defender reacts as you're going along. Whereas some attackmen will go and
have it set beforehand what they want to do.
Exactly, and if the defenseman reads that, you're done.
McGill setting up for the final minute of play here. Roar back behind the net. They'd love to get a late goal. We've seen a lot of late period goals in this tournament, and the momentum can make a difference, although they'll do stick checks at halftime, and that always seems to be a momentum swinger. Now the clock coming out. We're into the final 30 seconds of this first half. Goodwin starts a dodge, covered by Nedelko. There's a shot, the save, and Guelph's going to get an opportunity. Here comes Van Galen. He's going to have to try and get by Donovan on the ride. He'll pass it off, and Curtis Knight has the ball, and he's asking for a timeout immediately. We'll see if they announce how long is left in the half. The PA has been occasionally announcing the seconds remaining. Guelph timeout. They're going to have to run a pretty quick play, but we've seen them be very effective. You can bet that Curtis Knight is going to start with the ball right where he had it. He'll go back and take it. What do you see them running with this with not a whole lot of time left? Probably 10 to 15 seconds.
I would expect some sort of pick play to open up one of their top shooters for a shot. Just get him open, maybe even just within 10, 15 yards of the net, and let them just fire a shot. Either that or they'll try to get it low. Same thing, though. Probably a pick play. I doubt they'll go for a dodging play.
Yeah, not a whole lot of time. We have seen them run kind of a picket fence or almost like a basketball inbounds lineup, where they'll get a bunch of guys in a line and break free and have somebody try and come around the rest of the group. We'll see what they can work on. We'll see if that is Curtis Knight going down to get the ball.
I believe
it's
Ulbicus.
Yeah, Ulbicus starting with the ball. So they're going to have Knight on the other side. Knight is right in the middle of the field. They're spread out pretty wide. They're not going with the lineup. They're going to spread out and let Ulbicus try and run it. It's stripped. What a terrific play by Quinton Bradley.
Quinton Bradley is a player who give him a chance, like hang out your stick for even a fraction of a second like Ulbicus did there, and you will strip the ball from you.
And that will be halftime. And what a first half it is at the Bagataway Cup Championship Game 2013. 6 for the McGill Redmen, 6 for the Guelph Gryphons. Fantastic lacrosse. We hope you're enjoying it as much as we are. I'm Stephen Stamp for Ben Follows and the SSN crew. We're going to take a break over the halftime. We'll be back. Make sure you come and join us. Hello, lacrosse friends. Welcome back to the 2013 Bagataway Cup Championship game. I'm Steven Stamp with Ben Follows. And there's not a whole lot more you can ask for in a first half of a championship game. High quality play, a tie game, lots of excitement, some beautiful plays, and a fairly low-scoring game for these two teams, but that's because the defense has been working very hard and containing some of the offensive guys. Brandon McLean comes up with the opening faceoff, and that's a good sign for them. As you mentioned, he was not having the best success earlier. McGill setting up for the first possession of the second half.
McGill is just going to cycle it around while they change and get the players they want on.
There comes the pass over to Sassone Lawless. Scored the one of the games or the goals yesterday for McGill. Playing a nice job today. Goes
Anders Biela taking advantage of an open lane to the net and just bodied his way through, and he got close enough to the net to take a shot, and he took it.
Went down low, bounced it through. Great individual effort by Biela. I was talking to his father before the game. He's very excited to be up here. And, it's Biela coming in from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, as we mentioned, and these McGill players from all over. It's an interesting notice. They scramble for the opening, for the faceoff here. Everyone's still fighting for it, but the Guelph team, every single player from Ontario. So quite a difference in the makeup of the rosters and in the styles of the teams. Everyone's still fighting for it, and eventually McGill comes out with it. Bowie Hosking getting a big hand as he comes up with a nice play to get it.
Huge loose ball there.
Oh, and they create a chance, and Donovan is furious with himself for missing that. He saw an opportunity to get the lead back to two for McGill. They will, of course, maintain possession. And nobody going down to get the ball as they're still changing up. It was such a quick play there that McGill didn't even have all their personnel set.
Rohrbach took a great advantage there. Normally you'd want to slow it down there, but he saw Donovan was open, and Donovan took the opportunity.
Yeah, if you can put the ball in the back of the net, there's no need to have slowed it down. You don't need to change your personnel. Here's Biela up top again. McLean to Burnell and back. Biela fakes the pass, starts to slide in. They get it into the man in the crease. McLean, he gives it off to Donovan, and there's going to be a couple of flags go up. Not much question on that call, as everyone agreed on it.
Looks like a holding penalty to number 7 on Guelph. That will be David Nedelko.
And they're waiting to see who it's on, because there are a pair of players on top of him. It is a holding call.
Looks like it's Garrett Daly going. Correction, the penalty is not a number 7.
Yeah, it's 85 Garrett Daly going off. Oh, no, it's 22. Brandon Pitts actually will take the penalty, it looks like. We'll take a quick peek as they set up. There's a pair of Guelph players in the box.
McGill currently has a 6-on-4 in the offensive zone. We'll see what they do to capitalize on the opportunity. First power play of the game.
Actually, it's just, and they can take advantage of it, scoring. Not much surprise there, as they do get that big advantage.
And it looks like the play was to Connor Goodwin. They drew all the Guelph defenders down towards the net, passed it up to Connor Goodwin, who has a very nice shot, and just let him fire it. And you can see the result. They're up 8-6.
Pitts is released on that. And we're trying to see. Ryan Serville is kind of standing around the penalty area. There is an official sitting in one of the chairs there. So McGill has once again established a two-goal lead, their third straight two-goal lead. They're up 4-2, they're up 6-4, now they're up 8-6. Guelph once again will have to battle back. The officials getting together for a chat. I didn't hear an announcement of a penalty to Treville. I'm wondering if he had another illegal stick call, because we are now, though, over 3 minutes into the third quarter, so anyone that had a stick call off the top would be released. But Guelph still is short one player, as they have only 8 runners on the field. So we'll see if McGill can take advantage to really extend this lead. The centermen are down. And Van Galen, we could see him going early on that one. He had the ball out before the whistle had even blown, I think. So it's going to be McGill possession. He really wanted to get that one, but a little overeager, and that's going to hurt them. McLean trying to dodge to the net. Nice job by Daly to pick him up. There's Van Galen picking up his man. Shot from the outside, just missing by Goodwin. Goodwin loves to drop down and shoot from about hip level, and he just missed the outside corner on that.
Great recovery by the Guelph defense there. McLean drew the double and passed it off to Goodwin, but Goodwin had no chance because the Guelph defense recovered so quickly.
Yeah, they take away. I mean, that's a great point. When the shot goes wide, sometimes it's because they just didn't give you the lane to shoot at that would get it into the net. Guelph back to full strength. Drive, the save by Snyder, drops in behind him, and again, we're going to have a pair of flags. We're going to see who heads off this time. Looks like Daly running to the bench immediately, and there goes, I believe that's Van Galen, though, going to the box, and that really hurts them because he is their top defensive player. He's been a standout, been absolutely outstanding on Kevin Donovan today, and Donovan is pacing back and forth, wanting to get the play underway so he can play for a bit without being covered by Van Galen. 1 minute for illegal body check is the call. And both the flags went up at the same time, so you know the refs are on the same page when that happens. They move it down. There's a hard shot by Burnell. Saved by Snyder. He's having another terrific game today. What a great save on that one.
Yeah, he managed to adjust. He was misreading the shot, actually. He thought it was going low, but he's such a good goalie that he was able to adjust it and cover the high shot.
Excellent point. What a great recovery. McLean's going to let it fly. That one stopped again by Snyder. It's going to come out to Reese Burnell. He slips a little bit, recovers, passes it across. Goodwin. And we're going to have illegal procedure call. And Guelph will get the ball. A big break for them, as they should be able to run out the rest of the time, although they are still a man short down in their own end. Maybe a little difficult for them to clear.
It almost seemed like Snyder was picking up the slack for Van Galen there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Van Galen's been doing so much for this team. And now we have a flag up in the air. Delayed call. Guelph coming up the field. So that's going to help them out. Passing it down. There's the shot by Critch. Ulbeck has carried it all the way up. Got the pass off to Critch. He fired it. And we're going to have the penalty called now against McGill. Van Galen is back out on the field. So it will be a man advantage for the Gryphons. Curtis Knight starting with possession. Donovan takes a 1 minute slashing call. See if the Gryphons can creep back into it again. They're moving around nicely.
Great defensive play by Riley McGillis there, coming out of the net.
He's so active out of his net. He really likes to roam. At times it can be a problem, but I'll tell you, for the most part, it really works out well. Ulbeckus with a nice play to kick it over. And then Duchars manages to scoop it up. A tough break for Paul Ricozzi, who almost had a great steal. There's the shot. Guelph will get the ball back.
Watch Riley McGillis. If Guelph is trying to get one of their attackmen open on the crease, Riley McGillis is phenomenal at reading that and coming out to play the defender, play the attacker.
And he's quick enough that he can get back into position if they go down low on the near side while he's taking away that far side pass, because Guelph loves to hit Serville over on the far side. He's set up right on the crease now. They don't go. Oh, the pass. They tried to go to him. It was picked off. Great play there by Bradley Hoffman. Hoffman having a strong game, but now the ball is stripped free, but knocked out of bounds. Tough break there for the Gryphons as they knock the ball loose, and it goes out of bounds. It'll be McGill possession. And they're going to have. Let's see what the call is here. The officials having a discussion. They're still talking about it, trying to make sure they get it straight. It looked like it was fairly, looked like a fairly clearly distinct play where it was off the Guelph player. He knocked it loose, tried to scoop it up, and it bounced out of bounds for him. And that's the way it is going to go with McGill setting up. DeLangley will spin off a checker. There's Van Galen covering him with Donovan not back in the game yet. McGill taking their time. They've got five runners out there. On offense, they're just going to wait until the penalty is over as they have possession. And here they come, back to full strength. Donovan getting a bit of a rest after taking the slashing penalty. Prinzen has the ball. Prinzen one-on-one. Looked like he was going to spin dodge. Cuts to the net instead. Made his way past Calvin Holland, but the save on the short side. That one may have been going a bit wide anyway. Holland didn't give Prinzen a lot of room to shoot.
It almost looked like Nolan Prinzen cut off his own angle too much there. He went too far down, and by the time he had his arms open, he had no angle whatsoever.
Great little touch pass up to Lyons. Lyons is going to give it up now to Ulbicus. What a nice little play between the two long poles. That was Christian LeBlanc with the pass, just lobbing it up, leading his man perfectly. Moving around, Critch down to Treville. Back up to the top. Guelph just circling for the time being. Duchars loves to drive on this offside. Tries to get the pass through to Critch. He scoops it up off the turf. There's the cutter, the shot, the goal. Beautiful play by Serville. Passing it out and burying it is Ulbicus. Ulbicus was his third of the game and Serville with yet another assist.
Ulbicus and Serville are just such a great combination there. You've got Ulbicus, a strong player, cuts through the middle, takes the shot. Serville has got such great field awareness and can see the field. And he just put it right in Ulbicus' stick and he put it in.
Yeah, Serville just has been playing very well all weekend, but today he just seems to be even stepping his game up to another level with the passing game. Got a couple of beautiful assists, and Ulbicus really taking advantage of it. He's another player who's had a strong weekend for them. Looked like Van Galen was going to get that ball, but it's actually Daly picking it up. Garrett Daly having his best game of the tournament. His way was cut off from the bench, so he's going to run back to the near side of the field, pass it off to Taylor Brown. And Guelph doing a good job maintaining possession. It's 8-7. As we're a little over halfway through the third quarter, I'm Stephen Stamp with Ben Follows, bringing you this Bagataway Cup Championship for the title of the best team in the Canadian University Field Lacrosse Association. Guelph moving the ball again around the outside. Now they get set to move in. There's a shot by Duchars, and that one was stopped easily by McGillis. Almost the hockey-style shot into the net, but it went wide. I think you don't have that much control, and Duchars banged that one. It looked like a couple feet wide at the far post.
No, that would be the equivalent of a Hail Mary in lacrosse, just hoping for the best.
Yeah. Excellent point. There's the pass, the shot, the goal! Serville, what a beautiful pass from Critch, and Serville gets that one. My goodness, what a game that is. Four goals for Serville.
And Serville put that in with almost no room. We can see the angle he was shooting from where we are seated, and he had no angle, and he just snuck it past the legs of Riley McGillis.
Great point. He had almost nowhere to shoot, and you're looking at arguably the best goalie in all of Kufla in McGillis, and Serville was able to sneak it through on his offside. That's the first time we've seen him over on the offside, and
he's showing his versatility once again.
He is. Ben Van Galen with another face-off win. If there was an unsung hero award for this tournament, maybe he's been sung enough that he wouldn't be able to get it, but Ben Van Galen has been tremendous on the draws and on defense for this club.
Oh, yeah. He's impacted them. Like, if you can get possession, then that is 90% of the game right there, and he is their master of getting possession.
Especially when both teams have been so good at valuing possession, valuing the ball, not giving it up easily. It's been very hard to get the ball away from either team. Critch over to Serville. He's going to fight his way out on Nick's. Nick strips it. Who's going to get to the ball? It's Connor Duchars getting there first. Duchars coming from the goal line extended. Comes out. Scores. What a play. Oh, my. Oh. Connor Duchars. Goal of the weekend.
Goal. Oh, and there's this scuffle going on a bit.
A flag comes out afterwards, but Duchars the third straight goal. Every time McGill has taken a lead, Guelph has come back to tie it. This time they take the lead. They're first of the game.
Ducharz, that was just such a powerful drive to the net. Just drove right through, basically put his body in harm's way and pushed all the way, actually fell into the crease. He may have even fallen into the post. And just all the way, just wanted the goal and put it over Riley McGillis.
I was waiting to see if it was going to be a goal or if it was going to be called a crease violation, but he got it away, got it in before the before it went in, and the Guelph bench is jubilant. You can hear a bit of a Guelph contingent out in the stands cheering for them. Dan Williams taking the penalty for cross-checking after the goal. So Guelph gets the lead and goes immediately to the power play. The man up, Critch, is up high. He's going to pass it over to Kavanaugh, Michael Kavanaugh, with the ball. Kavanaugh taking his time, passes it down to Obikas. Jordan Critch hasn't spent much time up high. He's usually down below the goal line extended, and now he's heading back down there.
Guelph is looking for what I believe is their first two-goal lead of the game, which would be huge.
Well, this is their first one-goal lead of the game, so yeah, what a strip, though, by Bradley Hoffman. Hoffman, a bit of a relatively unknown compared to some of, you know, the Knicks and that for and Quentin Bradley for McGill. He may be their best defender today.
Oh, yeah. Well, especially there. That was a great recovery by him.
Mm-hmm. And then he loses the ball and recovers again to come and get it. Connor Goodwin either gets stripped or just lost. It looked like it just popped out of his stick under some duress from Jordan Critch. McGillis makes the pass again. As soon as there's an open man, and this time Connor Goodwin, McGillis makes the great pass right into his mesh. Curtis Knight covering him. That's a whole lot of midfield talent between those two there. McGill will just slow things down a little bit. Well, we wondered if the second half could match the excitement and the quality of the first half. I'd say it has so far. 9-8 for Guelph, with just about 5.5 minutes to play here in this McGataway Cup Championship game. Last year we had overtime, certainly not looking like a remote possibility here, as these teams just keep battling back and forth, nobody able to hold on to, well, McGill hasn't been able to hold on to a lead. We'll see what Guelph can do with their first lead of the day.
This entire game seems to be played in sets of two or three goals.
Biela with the hard shot from outside, looking for his hat trick, a little bit high though. McGill hangs on to the ball, this time it's Leland DeLangley back there. Rohrbach taking a bit of a break. Kevin Donovan directing traffic from the high slot. McGill with a lot of traffic right on top of the crease. Burnell in there, along with Biela. Here's DeLangley giving it off to Biela. A lot of movement, a lot of picking and rolling for the Redmen. And now they're going to open space up, give it to Donovan. He's going to throw it back up top to Goodwin, who's going to go for the dodge from the top. He's immediately picked up. That was David Nedelko on him. Pass over to Goodwin. Goodwin trying to get by Nedelko. Great recovery by Nedelko and some help from Pitts. Gets the ball stripped and a great job by Van Galen to come up with it. Getting there first. That is good team defense by the Gryphons. Van Galen taking his time. Brock's going to get a couple of men on. The slow clear. No pressure yet from McGill, but here comes Donovan to force him to make a bit of a play. Jeremy Snyder will take the pass.
Nedelko was very much playing Connor Goodwin's strong side. He's a very strong left-handed shot. Mm-hmm. However, he very rarely goes to his other hand, and David Nedelko did that. Had Connor Goodwin been willing to go to his right hand, he would have had the open shot. Nedelko assumed he wouldn't, and it paid off for him.
Ran him right into Pitts for the help. There's Guelph going quickly. Shot off the post. Serville almost had another one. Ducharz is going to track it down. And there's, as you're just pointing that out, great point about Goodwin and the strong hand preference. But a great pass by Christian LeBlanc. His second beautiful pass, a little flip touch pass over to Matthew Lyons. And I'll tell you, LeBlanc has really stood out as well this game with his stick work, with that long pole. It's not that easy to do. I mean, these guys obviously practice with it all the time and get used to playing with it, but it's not that easy to make some of those fine touch passes with the pole, and he's doing a nice job of it. Guelph moving the ball back around. We're into the final 3 minutes here of the third quarter. Guelph so far enjoying their first lead of the game for a few minutes now. Critch takes the pass from Serville behind the net, goes back up to Taylor Brown. A little bit of a wind picking up as we move on into the afternoon. still a glorious day for field lacrosse here at Percival Molson Stadium on the McGill campus. McGill, the home team. Jordan Critch, nice dodge, switches hands, switches back, reversing field. Some good Bradley Hoffman defense. Bradley Hoffman, very impressive today. Comes back up top to Curtis Knight. Guelph will reset. They've got Trevilian behind, but Jordan Critch has slid up into the slot. Taylor Brown now coming to replace him, and Critch will head back to his side.
Guelph has got a midfielder matchup in Ozzie Long, but Ozzie Long is...
Oh, what a shot. Jordan Critch, we talked about him standing down low. He hasn't scored a lot this weekend, but he's scored critical goals. There he gets one to give the Gryphons their first two-goal lead of the game. This Guelph club, certainly you almost think as the third game in 3 days goes on, they might get more tired. They seem to be getting better as the game goes on.
Yeah, it seems unbelievable that they seem to still look completely rested after three games, all of which have been very, very close. Like, they've had no time to relax.
No time at all in any of the games. Sam Kosakowski, their head coach, I talked to him after the game yesterday and asked him, you know, how are these guys going to be able to get up for a third? When he said, it's the biggest game of the year. If they can't get up, there's a problem. But I don't think it's going to be a problem. And it hasn't been so far. McGill, though, comes up with a faceoff. And they're going to try and eat into that two-goal lead as we come up to the final minute of play here in the third quarter. Sipperly trying to work it. Oh, sorry, that's Donovan over on the far side, on his offside, that is, on our near side. Roar back in behind the net. Roar back in. Again, McGill congesting the slot area. That's worked out pretty well for them to try and get some traffic in front and shoot off of screens off of there. Here's Prinzen all the way across to his offside. Hits Roarback. Up top to Prinzen. To Donovan. Donovan's heading back over where he's usually. Van Galen on him. The goal. Donovan. Oh, no, it's a save. I saw some hands go up. I thought it looked like it was going to be a goal, but what a save by Snyder.
That looked like it snuck through his legs, but he held on to it.
Spun around to make sure he had it. Now he's running up the field with the ball. Nice little pass to Obekas, who can't handle it. Obekas tries to get the ball. Snyder's just getting back, and McGill throws away that pass. They're going to hustle to see if they can keep it in. Great job by Goodwin.
Goodwin recovers Burnell's pass.
Now a flag has just gone up. The whistle had gone. I think the officials may have to discuss whether that foul occurred before, whether it was a timeout before the foul or was the end of the quarter. I'm not sure. I don't actually see the clock on the field, so it must be. Oh, yeah, the clock is on the field. Was it a timeout or was it the end of the quarter?
I believe it's the end of the quarter, but I'm not positive.
So we'll see if that foul is going to stand or if they decide that it happened after play had already ended. It is quarter time because the refs have got sticks to check. We'll see what the call is. I was talking to some of the officials last night. I'll tell you, we went to Schwartz's Beef Tech. Oh my goodness, best smoked meat in the world! And it was pretty funny because one of the officials was saying, "No, I don't like smoked beef. I'll have something else. I don't like smoked meat." And the server was saying, "Have you had our smoked meat?" He said, "I don't like smoked meat." He said, he brought him a sample. He said, "Okay, I'll have one of those. I'll have a sandwich." It was fantastic. Anyway, we were discussing it, and I've lost the point. I started thinking about Schwartz's smoked meat.
Must be good.
It's really good. Anyway, we're going to see if there is a foul. No flags coming so far off the stick checks. Looks like they've got three sticks. The referee is holding one stick behind his back. Normally they grab one stick from each team for the quarter and halftime stick checks. So we're waiting to see it. There may be a call here. When they're done, a flag may be thrown. Brandon McLean is speaking to the officials. They're handing the stick back now to Reese Burnell. Guelph's stick has already been given back to Olbicus.
Looks like there is a man in the box for Guelph.
I think that was the call at the end of the play there. It is Ben Van Galen again. And I think it is the call the flag that the flag went up before the end. They must have ruled it was before the end of the period. So we're getting ready for the fourth quarter. The score 10-8 for the Guelph Gryphons. McGill will have the ball and they will have a chance on the power play here to get the first one back with Van Galen off serving that penalty for 1 minute. Goodwin with the ball goes back up top to Biela. He shoots. Nice save by Snyder. That high to high shot. We saw a lot of high to high goals on Friday night, but they've been limited since. What a pass by Jeremy Snyder. Up to Ryan Serville, who'd come well back to help out his goaltender there.
That's a risky pass for Snyder, but it worked out beautifully.
It looked great because he did complete it. And Serville goes right through the two defenders, Hayden Nix and Brandon McLean. There's the pass, the shot, the goal. What a play. Curtis Knight finishing it. Ryan Serville. My goodness, what a game that kid is having.
That's a double hat trick, I believe, for Ryan Serville. And that is...
Well, he got the assist on that one because he set up Knight. Yeah. But,
okay, so five goals and at least an assist.
Yeah. What a game by Serville. And Curtis Knight has been fantastic all weekend.
That seemed like a bit of a defensive lapse for McGill. Who was the goal scorer, Critch?
It was Curtis Knight.
Curtis Knight? That was a bit of a defensive lapse. Curtis Knight came right in. He was not covered. I don't know what happened, but he was way too open, and McGill needs to shut that down if they want to come back from the three-goal deficit.
Well, they had the two men on Ryan Serville, and he slipped through them, so he was between them and the goal, which means they were completely out of position at that point when they tried to double-team him, and there just weren't enough players to cover everybody, and Curtis Knight is so good at cutting at just the right time. He took the perfect pass from Serville at the perfect time. A shorthanded goal. And that is a huge one for the Guelph Gryphons.
Yeah, Guelph took a complete advantage of a minor lapse in McGill's defense, and obviously they now have a three-goal lead.
I'm not sure that Tim Murdoch, their head coach, would think it was a minor lapse at this point, but there's another save by Jeremy Snyder. We're going to have a penalty on the check after the shot. Leland DeLangley with a nice shot saved by Snyder, and he is flattened, and it's going to be another Guelph penalty. This time it's Curtis Knight, it looks like, heading in. No, it will be...
And your point about the lapse is a good one, is that in championship games, even the most minor lapse can be a huge deal.
Yeah. Well, especially when you're down by two in the fourth quarter. It's Cooper Catt heads over for the penalty. He's upset with himself or with the call, maybe a bit of each. McGill, can they capitalize this time? Goodwin's going to shoot. Scores! You can just see that one coming. Is Guelph unable to step up on him?
And that is Goodwin's second power play goal, almost identical to the previous one.
He is... I would say arguably the best shooter from the outside in Kufla. There's some other great shooters, but Goodwin can just drop it down. And it's one of those things, you know it's coming. You know he's going to drop down, change the play, and go to about hip level.
Exactly.
And he still puts it in.
Well, it's just the strength and the release. It's so good that he just manages to put it behind the keeper every time.
We're going to have a timeout here. Didn't see who called it, but I'm assuming it's McGill, as Cooper Catt is still in the penalty area.
Yeah, McGill will be calling that to preserve the remaining time on the power play.
Yeah. So 11-9 for Guelph with 17:25 to go here in the third period. This is great lacrosse.
Oh, it's phenomenal. I don't think I've seen a game this exciting in a while.
And that includes, we've been here for some games this weekend. I mean, the Queens Western game, I think, was a tremendously exciting game, the big comeback. But for overall quality of play, this has been better. I mean, that was, both teams had some shaky moments there, first game of the weekend and a little maybe Bagataway nerves. But there's been very little. I mean, someone mentioned to me in the half, I said, no, the quality of play is so high. And they said, oh, there's been a few drop passes. And I was like, three. Yeah. There have been three drop passes in the entire half. And
there have been maybe five or six mistakes total the entire game. Other than that, it's just great playing.
Not a lot of mental errors either. Both teams obviously very well coached. Got to give some props to Tim Murdoch and his coaching staff with McGill, Sam Kozakowski and his coaching staff with Guelph, doing a great job preparing their teams for this game. Guelph, and the thing is, Guelph, kind of remembers a three seed coming into this tournament. They won Friday night in what was considered an upset over Bishops. They won yesterday in what was considered an upset over Brock. And now they lead by 2 goals, 2.5 minutes into the fourth quarter. Now what they really need is to manage to kill this, a huge faceoff. Possession will be so important here. It's being battled for. McLean scoops it up. Great faceoff by McLean. He flips it over, gets it to Goodwin. Goodwin directing traffic. He's telling Danny Williams to get off and let the offensive guy get on while they have a brief power play remaining.
Just That's a missed pass by Goodwin. He can't be doing that.
And that will eat up most of the rest of the time. So just as we praise everyone for not missing any passes or making any mistakes, we have a little one. And again, a little one could be a big play. They still got a bit of time, though. Rohrbach slipping around behind the net. He's going to get it out to Goodwin. No shooting lane. He's going to pass it over. Now Biela wants to shoot. He's got Van Galen on him. Gets it over to Donovan.
Will shoot.
Oh, and there's the save by Snyder.
Phenomenal save by Snyder.
That ball had something on it. I mean, if there's somebody who is a better shooter than Goodwin, it might be Kevin Donovan. So that's a great save. And it's going to be Guelph ball off the procedure foul. Go ahead, Ben. Sorry, I cut you off there.
Oh, I was just talking about how strong of a shot Kevin Donovan has. Him and Goodwin can both just fire the ball, and it's hard to stop. But Snyder has been doing a great job at stopping what he can.
And Curtis Knight uses his speed and agility to run away from Rohrbach and Williams and get up, or Rohrbach and Donovan, get up into the offensive zone. The penalty is over. We're back at full and even strength. It's 11-9 with 4 minutes gone here in the fourth quarter. 16 minutes left to play for the Bagataway Championship. Ryan Serville, who's been outstanding all weekend and at his best today, moves it around. That pass skips away from Duchars, but he's going to have time to track it down. You'd see Ozzie Long's eyes light up as he tried to light out after that, but couldn't quite get there in time. Great positioning by Duchars to get it. Pass over to Ilbikas. Nice dodge. Passes it over. Shot by Taylor Brown. Picked up behind the net by Serville.
Great dish there by Ilbikas. He drew the double and gave Duchars the chance to shoot.
Nice pickup, nice awareness by Ryan Treville of where that ball was going so he could get it before it got away. I'm not sure it would have made it to the end line. Scooped up the loose ball. Here comes McGill, and you can hear the crowd. Almost everyone in the stands is cheering for McGill, of course, here in their home stadium, Percival Molson Stadium at McGill. And they have the ball. Paul Ricosi. What a goal by McGill. Connor Goodwin with his hat trick. He has been very good for them today. A little quiet in the first half, but he has really come on here in the second. 11-10 into the final 15 minutes. McGill creeps within one goal. What a play by Goodwin. Just running about 30 yards on his own and ripping that one home. Again, possession so critical. McLean has started to fare better in the faceoff circle of late. Let's see if he can come up with this one. It's going to be contested. McLean tries to pick it up with one hand, can't. Oh, and a tough break for the Gryphons as a player just overran Calvin Hall and just overran the ball, and it was picked up by Boy Hoskins. McGill with possession and a chance to tie things up here. Donovan gives it to McLean. Goes up to Goodwin. Ball comes down to the far side to Burnell. They move it back up to Goodwin. Goodwin's been the hot hand. He's got the last 2 goals for them. He's going to look to shoot again. He does. It's a bit wide. We're going to see. Oh, and they call McGill possession. It was very close. Christian LeBlanc almost got there in time. But instead, Alex Rohrbach takes the ball. Rohrbach just beating LeBlanc to the end line to gain possession back for the Redmen. 11-10, 13.5 minutes to go now. Guelph Gryphons leading the Bagataway Cup Championship. DeLangley. He's got McLean with him behind the net. They've got Donovan has slid up high along with Rohrbach. A lot of traffic in the slot area. Nice check by Holland to knock the ball free. It's still on the ground. We've got a possession call going. It's going to be McGill ball. So Holland called for possession, possession foul. Just a little bit procedural push in the back. McGill has it. Donovan trying to dodge the net. He's watched, as always, by Ben Van Galen. Goodwin trying to find some shooting space. He's going to let it rip. Save. It's either off the post or off the stick of Jeremy Snyder. Either way, it heads out the back line. McGill, once again with possession. Leland DeLangley dodging it from behind. Holland did a nice job getting in his way, not letting him get out and get the shot. Now he gets up high at the 20-yard line. The pass, the sub shot by Donovan with the man right on top of him. Snyder had to be alert to pick that one up right off the ground. Passes over to DeLangley, to Van Galen. Van Galen's going to make the long pass. Donovan trying to track down that defender. Not quite able to. That's Christian LeBlanc. He's going to go for a bit of a run. Got plenty of space. Makes a nice pass off to Ryan Serville, who once again has come back a long way back from his attack position to help out as they cleared. Great work by Guelph there to get the ball out. A couple of goals right in a row by Connor Goodwin, so Guelph wants to slow things down, hold on to possession, give their defense a bit of a rest, get their breath back, and then they're going to want to attack the net and try and restore a two-goal lead. Olbikas over to Duchars. I'm Steven Stamp with Ben Follows. The shot by Duchars. It goes wide, but Guelph has a couple of players back, and they will get possession. Ryan Serville will scoop up one of the many balls in the end zone.
Strong shot by Duchars. He shot for the corner and missed, but it had clearly had the potential to be a dangerous shot.
Serville throws it back up to Duchars, who's over on his normal side. Curtis Knight taking his time, surveying the field. Pass it over to Taylor Brown. He's going to go behind the net to Critch behind the GLE. Back up to Brown to Knight. Duchars quietly making his way into the slot area. Here's Olbikas, the shot, the goal! And that's one I think Riley McGillis might like to have back, because Olbikas just went high to high right above him. Might have thrown enough of a fake to make McGillis think he was going low, because McGillis seemed to think it was going to be coming down lower than it was.
Yeah, McGillis just had a second of hesitation there, and with shooters at this level, you're going to pay if you have even a millisecond of hesitation.
How about Olbikas with four goals today? He's had an outstanding game.
Oh, he's played phenomenally. He is just such a strong player. As I've said before, he just dodges through the middle, and you can't touch him. He'll get the shot off.
Very good. He is a very good player, but, I mean, he had 14 goals in 11 regular season games. He's not getting a lot of four-goal games, but he's saving his best for the biggest game of the year. And Guelph is coming way back into their own end. Garrett Daly running back. Now Van Galen has it. He's got Snyder open behind the net. He's going to wait for some pressure from Rohrbach and then throw it over to him. Van Galen's so poised when he has the ball in his own zone. You cannot force him into making a bad pass.
Oh, yeah. He's a very smart player, and he's phenomenal under pressure. He's had a few penalties, but other than that, he's had no mistakes this game. Now Guelph is dodging.
Oh, what a spin move and the shot. Huge
and a
goal
by number two, Jordan Critch.
Jordan Critch is second of the quarter, reestablishes the three-goal lead.
He had a little roll inside and low underhand shot that Riley McGillis just wasn't fast enough to get. Nothing you can do there. A strong dodge and a good shot. Now McGill is once again down by three with 9 minutes to go. Not a huge deficit, but in this game that might just be enough since McGill has yet to have a two-goal lead. And
No, McGill's had 3 2-goal leads.
I meant no
three-goal
leads.
Oh, yeah.
My mistake.
Good point.
They haven't been able to establish three goals in a row just yet, but let's see what they can do. They need 3 goals in the next 9 minutes. Goodwin is taking it down the right side, passes to Rohrbach.
Rohrbach goes behind the net to Donovan, who throws it back out, and I'll tell you, this is a big lead for the Guelph Gryphons. Be a bit of a Cinderella story for him. The hard outside shot there by Sipperly. That one goes wide. This time it's Donovan back there establishing that they will get possession.
Like you said, it'd be a bit of a Cinderella story. They're coming in as the 3 seed. They were 9-3 on the season, whereas McGill, on the other hand, they're the defending Kufla champions, undefeated since, I believe, the middle of last season. So for Guelph to come in and beat Western, Brock, and McGill would be just a phenomenal story.
Yeah. And like we said, it would establish the fifth winner in the last 5 years of the Bagadway Cup. Guelph won it in 2008. Since then, and they were the start of a string of five in 5 years. There's a nice play by Christian LeBlanc as some pressure from Rohrbach forced the errant or the low pass from Snyder. Great play by Van Galen to get it into Ulpicus. Ryan Serville taking his time. They're going to just set up. No hurry for the Guelph Gryphons at this point with just 7 minutes to go and lots of time.
Yeah, McGill is going to need to start taking some risks if they want to come back because Guelph is just going to hold onto the ball as much as they can. We've got Guelph taking it behind the net. Ozzie Long is defending him. Ozzie Long is one of the few short stick defenders in the league who can play against the best attackmen. Normally, an attackman will beat a short stick no matter what, but Ozzie Long is the exception. He's an extremely strong, and now we're going to see Duchard is dodging on Ozzie. Ozzie still has him. And pass to Ulbicus in the middle, ends up in the back of the net. A great shot by Ulbicus. I believe that is his fifth of the game. That he is having just a phenomenal game.
It's he's just been outstanding. Oh, yeah. Great job. And Ryan Serville has been so good. These Gryphons really stepping up, having their best game of the season in the biggest game of the season. That's exactly what you want as a team.
And Brett Ulbicus, that was a phenomenal catch and a shot by him. He was surrounded in the middle and managed to catch it and get the shot off, giving Guelph a four-goal lead with 6 minutes to go.
Yep, 14-10, and every tick of the clock brings Guelph closer to their first championship in 6 years. That ball, everyone battling for it, can't quite pick it up. Nice shoulder check there by Bailey.
Huge loose ball here.
It goes out. Who's it off? Saying it's off of Guelph, so McGill gets the ball. Kevin Donovan will take it. Garrett Daly working hard. Everyone battling for that ball, but eventually did bounce out off a Guelph defender. Kevin Donovan takes it. He's going to step in, throw it up to Connor Goodwin now. Goodwin with a terrific second half after being fairly quiet early. The one-hand pass gets away from him, but it does go up to Biela. Biela switches hands. He's got Curtis Knight on him. Shoots. That one's wide. But Rohrbach in great position. Christian LeBlanc, 10 yards behind the goal. Rohrbach made sure he was just a yard further, so he's able to get possession for McGill. He rolls out, makes the pass over to Goodwin. He hits the cutter. There's a shot a little bit high. Flag is up and down on the ground. It looks like it's going to be LeBlanc taking the penalty, and he heads immediately over to the bench. Gets his kneel and starts the penalty clock. The clock on the penalty ticking. We're in the final 5 minutes, a four-goal lead for Guelph. Cooper Catt hustles in to replace that long pole position.
This is a huge power play for McGill. They've got to score here if they want to take back the lead. They need four goals in the next 4 minutes, and there's the shot.
Oh, big save. Oh, actually, I'm guessing that went off of Cooper Catt because he has gone down hard.
Yeah, this doesn't look good.
He just went down like a ton of bricks. Their trainer's out immediately, and he is laying pretty inert on the field. Obviously, a lot of pain, and we mentioned how hard Kevin Donovan can shoot. And, boy, you got a feel for that. I mean, a very brave play being in the shooting lane. But right now, Cooper Catt paying the price for it.
Did you see what happened there? Did he just get hit with the shot?
I think he must have. It was hard to tell from up here whether it hit him or whether it got through and Snyder made the save. But I'm guessing it must have hit Catt because what else could it have been? To have felled him like that. I mean,
exactly.
He dropped like a tree. So, 4 minutes and 38 seconds to go. The Guelph Gryphons, as time has stopped, have the four-goal lead, 14-10. Ben follows. If you're McGill, what do you do? Obviously, you've got to find a way to get a goal here. Who do you want shooting the ball, for one thing?
All the usual suspects. You want Goodwin. You want Donovan. You want Prinzen. You want Biela. Maybe Burnell, if it's necessary. You want all your usual suspects. Rohrbach. I don't think Rohrbach has scored yet today. He's normally one of their most lethal shooters, and I believe he's being shut down by LeBlanc, and LeBlanc is doing a phenomenal job of that.
LeBlanc has been terrific today. This is his best game of the tournament. And that's what you want, those guys. And Ben Van Galen, of course, on Donovan, keeping him largely off the score sheet. Donovan does have a couple. I'm not sure you're ever going to keep Kevin Donovan from scoring at least a little bit.
No, of course not. But even if you can shut him down to one or two goals in the game.
And there's not a lot of movement at this point from Cat. We're hoping that he's okay. There's some teammates around him now.
Hopefully the trainers are just keeping him still so he doesn't strain anything, but hope for the best.
So McGill with, as we mentioned, 4.5 minutes to go. We've already looked at what we want them. If I'm them, I'm getting the ball to Connor Goodwin because I think he's got the hot hand, and I'd be looking to get him, letting him shoot on the move if possible. Try and set up a screen, get him the ball and set up a screen so he can come off of something and get a shot off. If you're Guelph, what are you trying to do to take away that possibility?
You're trying to just make sure that McGill does not have high-quality shots. You're making sure that either they're taking shots from bad angles or far outside shots with a guy coming down on your hands. You don't want to give the shot that they've been giving up quite a few times today, which is Connor Goodwin or Kevin Donovan right down the middle with a long shot.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, they also need to get the ball back and just hold on to it. Kill as much of the clock as possible. They've got a 4-goal lead that's comfortable with 4 minutes to go.
They are bringing out the board, so that doesn't look good. We got to feel for Cooper Catt here. Hope that he's all right. They're obviously just bringing it out. We're hoping it's just a precaution to make sure that, like you said, nothing gets strained. They have, I believe, rolled him over at this point partway. They're getting the board in position. And obviously our thoughts with him right now. And I'll tell you, it's we don't want it to, you know, we don't want to minimize what's going on with him right now. But once again, what a phenomenal performance by this Guelph lineup. And, you know, you can go up and down. Players, Jordan Critch has had a great game, a few really nice setups, a couple of critical goals here in the fourth quarter. Ryan Serville has been an absolute beast. Brett Olbakus with 5 goals has been a great story for them. I mean, what a day. We were talking about how he doesn't have many 4-goal games, and he got 5 of them. And you talked about Serville. It's interesting. Serville scoring on his 4 goals on 4 different moves, 4 different looks. Olbakus has 3 or 4 of his on pretty much the same play.
Olbakus, yes, but at the same time, you have Olbakus doing something. He's found what works, and he's doing it over and over again. McGill has yet to figure out how exactly to shut that down.
And again, you look at the Guelph lineup. You've got Ryan Serville with 34 goals, Curtis Knight with 28 goals, and you've got a bunch of scorers. Jordan Critch had 16 goals and 34 assists, the most in Coughlin. He's got a couple of goals. He's obviously a threat. Connor Duchars was great yesterday. You know, who are you gonna leave open? You might think maybe Olbakus isn't quite as, he's not maybe quite as dangerous as those guys, but he's showing today that if you give him some space, he can hurt you very much, just as the others can.
Exactly. He's one of those guys that if you put your best defenders on everyone else, you're going to end up with Olbakus coming down the middle and picking up the slack. And that just shows how strong a Guelph team Guelph is, just that they can have their top players shut down, and their top players will still find a way to score, and they'll still and they have guys who can pick up the slack.
Now, they do have Cooper Catt onto the spinal board. He's been rolled over onto it. They're getting the neck braces, so it's not certainly not good to see. I mean, it's tough to see somebody get hurt
It's a terrible thing to see. Hope the best for him.
Absolutely.
Hope he's okay.
Absolutely. Especially when he takes that shot. We're guessing it was the shot. We're not able to have replays, unfortunately, but he must have just been hit by that shot, and it was a hard shot, and certainly, you know, no blame on Kevin Donovan who took it. He's just ripping it trying to get to the net, and Guelph has been getting in the shooting lanes all weekend. But, you know, what would it mean to this Guelph program to come back after not having won it for 5 years? You know, we talked before the game, we talked at halftime about are they going to be a little flat having had two such emotional wins Friday and Saturday? No, they weren't flat. Are they going to get tired in the third and fourth quarter? No, they've been even better than they were in the first half. I mean, what more can a team do to show that they're
exactly
deserving champs?
At this point, at the very least, they've just got so much adrenaline going and so much excitement going. They're so close to this championship game, like 4 minutes, 4 goals ahead. Basically, it's their game to lose at this point.
And, you know, don't go away, though, because we have seen some fantastic comebacks. I mean, Queens scored three goals in 20 seconds in the final 32 seconds of play to beat Western. And, you know, that was a huge, huge comeback by Queens. A great show of tenacity. Definitely a bit of an upset for them to take out the Mustangs. One thing that both the third seeds winning ensured was that we would have an East-West final, because it was two Eastern teams playing in the one semifinal as Queens took on McGill, and the other was two Western teams with Brock and Guelph. So certainly teams that were familiar with each other.
Yeah.
And, you know, just while we touch on Queens, what a great tournament for them. Their first time ever. 2 years ago, they were 0-10 in Kufla East. Last year, they started to make some strides. This year, with a second straight strong rookie class, they get to their first ever Big Attaway Cup, and they win a game, beating the Western Mustangs. And then they come out, fall behind 8-1 to McGill at the half. The game was clearly more or less over in terms of them winning the game. They came out and led or were tied in terms of the second half for much of that much of that play. Wound up losing 15-6, where it scored 7-5 in the second half, but what a great effort by the Queens Gales in the second half.
Oh, yeah, Queens
yesterday.
Was definitely an unexpected triumph in this tournament, especially beating Western, who lost to McGill in overtime of the Kufla Championship last year at Trent.
Great point. And, you know, it speaks very well for the league that the competition is getting so strong. I mean, you look at a Trent team that was in the Gataway last year as the hosts, and in it as a, you know, earning their way in the year before and being very competitive throughout the league. They're kind of rebuilding, but they can play with anybody on any given day. Queens is obviously taking huge strides in their program. Hopefully, you know, those two and some of the other Eastern teams will be able to raise the level of play overall in the East, because McGill and Bishops have been doing such a great job. You want to have that parity.
Oh, yeah.
And we're getting more and more of it with an influx of terrific players into Kufla over the last several years.
Well, you have teams like Queens and Carleton who have especially in the last few years, haven't really been competitors. Like, it's always been McGill and Bishops and then sort of the fight for third and fourth. But recently, especially with Queens beating Western, it just shows how much improvement has come in those in that section of the league.
And they have now picked up Cooper Catt. They've got that board up. And they're carrying him off. And McGill was actually just starting to make their way to the dressing room. But now the one thing here with the lead, it's going to be an emotional time for Guelph to have seen their comrade fallen. We'll see how they are able to play, how they're able to focus during the when we start playing again. Sorry, I'm having a little trouble with my word there. When we get going again, we'll see if they are able to emotionally and mentally stay focused and just stay in this game. The McGill crowd is giving a cheer both for Cooper Catt who's being taken off the field and for their McGill Redmen. And we are ready to go back underway. McGill will have the ball. They had possession as that shot bounced off of Catt and out the back. Now remember, Guelph is still short a player. They have one man over in the box. Just have to remind ourselves it was Christian LeBlanc who took that penalty. So McGill will be looking to score quickly. And, of course, if they can get one while he's still in there, you imagine they'd take a timeout again and try and take advantage of that man advantage.
McGill needs to take every advantage they can right now. They need to get some quick goals and then get some momentum going their way.
Things cooling off a little bit as the afternoon progresses, but still a beautiful day, and I don't think it's bothering anyone down on the field at this point. But with that bit of a long break, and now the team's heading off to their benches. I'm not sure if we've got a timeout called or just as we're going to get underway. And I was saying, you know, they've had a bit of a long break, everyone's standing around as the afternoon is cooling. Wonder if that will affect anyone. We'll see how sharp the initial the first 30 seconds or so of play are once they get back underway. The team's gathering over at their benches. Kevin Donovan, quite animated in a huddle of the McGill players on the field. Looks like the gates are open at the end of the field. We may be There's some speculation that we may be waiting for an ambulance to take Cooper Cat off just to make sure that he's okay. Just want to take every precaution. But the team's definitely over their sides. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back in just a couple of minutes as when play is ready to resume. Thanks for being with us. I'm Stephen Stamp with Ben Follows for SSN's coverage of the Bagataway Cup. We'll be back shortly. Hello, lacrosse friends. Welcome back to the Bagataway Cup 2013 Championship. We will be back underway with the game shortly. We just want to update you on the condition of Cooper Catt. He is fine. We've got reports that he was hit in the back of the head with the shot, was a little shaken up, but he is fine. He's moving and responding. He's alert. And he actually told his coach he wanted to continue the game, but they said, no, not a chance. We're taking you to the hospital as a precaution. So we did wait. The ambulance is in the stadium. As you can see, he's being loaded into the back of it. He will be taken off to the hospital for precautions, but apparently he is fine, talking, moving. He's getting a nice round of applause from everyone in the crowd, and he is fine. So we were sure that you were going to be wondering about that. We were wondering ourselves for a bit.
Exactly.
How he was doing, but I mean, it's great to hear, because the last thing you want marring it. I mean, most importantly for him to be okay, and you don't want it to mar the game either. He's been certainly a very good player for them. Cooper Catt has, and we did have a question about Brett Ulbicus, who has had a tremendous game, and wondering where he's from. He is an Oakville, Ontario native, as we mentioned earlier. Every player on this Guelph team is from Ontario, and now everyone is up and cheering again as the McGill Redmen emerge from their dressing room. Guelph is already out on the field. They've got their guys ready to go. Just a reminder, Guelph does have a player in the penalty area, Christian LeBlanc, with a bit of time left on his penalty. All the players have returned to the field, and we'll be underway shortly. The ambulance is still on the track. It'll be heading out. They've got Catt in the back of the ambulance. The officials are all gathered over at the timer's bench. And you know, we were talking off air, Ben, about what's going to happen when they come out. Will Guelph rally around their fallen comrade and do it for him? Sam Kosakowski is in a huddle with them, very animated, really. He's a passionate guy, a passionate coach, getting them. I think he's saying, let's do it for Cooper. Let's
It's very important for him just to make sure that Guelph doesn't lose the momentum. They've had the momentum for probably the majority of the fourth quarter. But with a break that long, they need to make sure that they keep it, because McGill could completely turn this around in the last 4 minutes.
They could, especially, you know, they get a little momentum going. We've seen some big swings, and, you know, it's hard to say what exactly will happen. The other side, of course, we talked about how they could come out and play for him, and really Guelph could almost up the level of their game, or they could be distracted. I mean, it's tough when you see your teammate go down. It's going to be a big boon for them that he is okay, and they know he's okay. They've been told that he's fine, so that's a big statement for them. McGill has had some time now. The players did get a chance to come out and warm up and run around and make sure they were ready to go, so it should negate any
exciting 4 minutes left in the
game. Should be. That's the thing with McGill. They haven't necessarily played their very best offensive game today. Scoring 10 goals, they haven't been too bad, but they have the talent to score 4 goals in 4 minutes and 38 seconds, there's no question.
And Guelph has done a great job at limiting the chances of McGill's most lethal players, such as Donovan and Rohrbach.
Yeah, a lot of credit. I mean, we've talked quite a bit about Ben Van Galen. He's been outstanding. I mean, a spectacular game. But, you know, Christian LeBlanc, who's in the penalty box right now, has been terrific. Brandon Pitts, number 22, the short pole defender, we've seen some very good things from. David Nedelko, of course, number 7, is a very solid, sound guy. They've got Matthew Lyons, number 4, has played very well. It's been a great team effort by this Guelph club. You know, Curtis Knight, a great defender as a midfielder. So we'll see exactly the 5 guys they've got out there to try and kill this penalty. Van Galen.
Who do they have replacing Cooper Catt?
That would be... Well, they've got Pitts out there. Oh, they've got Nicholas Wortman, a long pole from Burlington, is out there. The first action he's seen. So we'll see if the McGill Redmen go after him. He's over on the far side of the field. If we've got a shot, he's standing there talking to the goalie, Jeremy Snyder. and to Brandon Pitts. And Wortman certainly will be under the spotlight here, taking that spot, especially since they're shorthanded. And Christian LeBlanc, who's been so good today, is the man over serving the penalty. So we'll see if they go over to, if McGill goes to, that would be Eric Sipperly is over on the far side. Kevin Donovan and Alex Rohrbach are behind the net having a bit of a chat. Brandon McLean's over on the far side. Connor Goodwin is up around midfield. And also Anders Biela is the sixth offensive player for McGill right now.
It'll be interesting to see what kind of play McGill runs, especially considering that their previous plays have not worked quite as well as they would have hoped.
I would be inclined to go after the guy who's just come into the game. You don't want to, you know, not that you want to be heartless, but I mean, go after the guy who hasn't played all day.
Yeah, no, he won't be nearly as warmed up. That being said, most of these guys won't be as warmed up as they would like because of the break in the play.
Yeah, but it was actually a long enough break that they did get the chance, like we said, to have another warm up, to have a chance to make some passes, and run around a bit. They all formed, and McGill actually went back into the change room. So hopefully, everyone is ready to go. You want to see the best of each team in the critical moments of the game.
Another aspect to bring into that, though, is the mental aspect. Are you still mentally in the game when you've been out of it for that long?
Right.
And that will be a lot dependent on the coaches. The coaches need to make sure that the guys remain focused and are thinking about what they need to do to win this game.
I'll tell you, and in that, from that perspective of will they be mentally ready, you've got a McGill team that's gone 10-0, 11-0 when you include their semifinal win, and seem to have been up to every challenge they've faced this year. And you've got a Guelph team that has come in as underdogs in both of their games and played brilliantly throughout. So I think we can safely say that they've got excellent coaching staffs on both sides, and the players are ready. We are now getting prepared to go. The ambulance is making its way around the track, as you can see, just following it around. You know, the nice, neat thing about this stadium, Percival Molson Stadium, one of the cool things, if you walk around the track, just where the ambulance is going now, there are offices from the, I assume, from the athletic department, and from the medical department.
I believe it's neuroscience, actually.
Neuroscience, there you go. Obviously, I know way less than you guys, but it's just neat seeing the offices that look out onto the field.
I've always been shocked that I haven't seen any windows broken.
I know. I wondered about that myself. I mean, now they are a fair ways away from the field, but still, some of those, especially in lacrosse, some of the balls can get down there with some alacrity. All right, the ambulance is making its way off again. Cooper Cat is fine. Took a shot to the back of the helmet. Was knocked down. He's alert. He's moving. He's doing just fine. And we are back underway with 4.5 minutes to go here in the Bagataway Cup 2013 Championship. McGill with the man advantage, trying to take advantage of it. Moving the ball around. Here's Goodwin. Oh. Comes to the net. Shoots a little bit wide. They're going to get the ball back as Sipperly will get over there first. But Guelph is now back to full strength. Curtis Knight comes onto the field. We'll see if they get a chance to get Wortman out. He's got to be feeling some pressure. Sipperly passes the ball in behind the net to Donovan. Donovan's going to come out to Wartman's side, but he's got Van Galen all over him. Circling around is Donovan. Bit of a grab. Donovan scores.
Goal.
And the penalty. I was just going to say, Van Galen put the grab on Donovan. Donovan scores anyway with the low shot, and that's going to send, the penalty is wiped out as it was a releasable penalty.
Great goal by Donovan. Came around the net, and as he was being taken down by Van Galen, shoveled the ball through the legs of Snyder. Phenomenal goal, but that's exactly what McGill needs to do. They need to be putting their heart into it and just going all out. No worries about risks or anything right now.
Yeah, I mean, if you give up a goal or two, you know, you've still lost.
Yeah,
well, you know, whether you lose by one or lose by six, it doesn't make any difference. They just got to pull out all the stops. Possession, so critical once again. Who's going to come up with it? Scrummed again. The wingers come in. It bounces away. We're going to have a procedure call against McGill, and it is Guelph possession. They're going to see how much time they can kill. We're coming down to the final 3 minutes. The clock in the stadium will stop shortly, and it will be in the hands of the timers. Well, it always is in the hands of the timers at the official timing station. Here's Ulbicus, who's been outstanding today, running away from a pair of McGill defenders. We're going to have a timeout called by Guelph.
Big timeout call by Guelph. They were at risk of losing the ball there. Ulbicus was doubled and threw it away.
Perfect timing as they got the timeout call just before he lost the ball, and we're just under the 3-minute mark. with a three-goal lead. A lot of threes, and we'll see what Guelph can do. And obviously, they're going to keep the ball on the outside, as, you know, a fair bit, take their time as much as they can. You'd have to assume you're going to see a stall warning at some point if they're too slow.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Guelph is going to try to slow down the ball as much as they can, just kill the clock off. But at the same time, McGill needs to be aware that if they give Guelph the opportunity to shoot, they will. Because obviously a four-goal lead will help them.
And, I mean, Riley McGillis, who we talked about, how effective he is when he leaves his goal area, his crease area. And he's going to have to get out and be helping out with some defensive coverage.
He will be expected to probably pick up one of the attackmen defensively. They will probably double the ball, put two defenders on the ball, and Riley McGillis will defend one of the attackmen, leaving the net open, hopefully, so that those two defenders on the ball can strip him and get the ball down to the McGill offense.
Looks like Curtis Knight is heading down to start with possession of the ball in the corner. He is such a reliable player. He's going to be double-teamed immediately. And Riley McGillis already is out. He's on Connor. Is he on Connor Duchars? Actually, have they pulled McGillis?
No,
McGillis
is out
near midfield.
Yeah.
Covering Taylor Brown, so nobody in the McGill net. Curtis Knight running around. He's gonna swim through. Loses it. Doesn't know where the ball
is. Huge loose ball here.
Everyone's still battling for it. About half a dozen players after it.
Huge battle.
Players hitting the ground. It's shoved
aside. Like dominoes out there.
We have a possession, a procedure call. It's going to be a push, and it's McGill possession. So they get the benefit of the call after that massive battle, everyone going hard, recognizing how important that possession of that ball was.
And
there comes the D. Quinton Bradley gets it over
off
the goal
the crossbar.
Post. Rolls back to Snyder. A crossbar shot by Eric Sipperly, and the long pass
great
by Snyder.
Great run by Hoffman there.
That was. Oh, that Bradley Hoffman. Sorry, my bad. But Hoffman with a great run. He's had a tremendous game. They get the ball up to Ryan Serville. Serville, the man of the hour today, is triple teamed. He's got Hayden Nix all over him. The ball is down. Nix has it and comes running out, but we're going to have a call. Is it a timeout or is it a procedure call? Is it? Are they giving Guelph a timeout, saying that they got the call before McGill established possession? The refs are having a chat. So far, no indication. They're just talking it over. We're going to see.
I do not believe that Guelph called the timeout, but I can't be certain.
It looks like they may be indicating a McGill timeout. It's really hard to see from up here. They're heading over to talk to the coaching staffs and the players to let them know what's going on. I wish somebody would tell us so we can share it with you. We're into the final 3 minutes. There's got to be, about 2 minutes left, Ben, at this point? Maybe a minute and a half?
That would be my guess, yeah.
Yeah. And, wow, 14-11 for Guelph.
This is a huge call for the refs. We'll see what they'll do.
It appeared to us that certainly the ball had been knocked free, knocked away from Rancherville before the whistle went. But, of course, it's the intention of when the referee is...
When the referee decided to make the call, not when he actually blew the whistle.
2:04 left to play in the fourth quarter. They've just announced over the PA system. And still no indication whose ball it is. And therefore, who called the timeout? It would be massive if Guelph has possession. And judging by the way McGill is...
Connor Goodwin is maybe picking up the ball.
I think it might be Guelph possession, judging by the way McGill is setting up their players.
Yes, it looks like it is.
Oh, my. That is a huge call. So Guelph, we're going to have to assume, got the call for a timeout. If Ryan Serville made that call, that is an absolutely brilliant call.
Absolutely.
He's about to lose it. I don't know if it came from the bench or from the field. Connor Duchars will start with the ball. He'll be double-teamed immediately. Again,
Riley
McGillis
McGill
is out covering someone on Taylor Brown. The net wide open.
And Duchars holding on to it.
Swim move. Gets through. splits
Ball's
them.
Down.
Oh, he rolls it over to Serville. What a play by Duchars. It's knocked loose, though. McGill trying to scoop it up, and it rolls. Not quite. It does roll out of bounds. Guelph ball.
I believe Hayden Nix knocked that out of bounds when he was trying to pick it up.
It was right by the sideline. He had to try quickly to get it. Knight can't quite pull in that pass. Not scooped up, though, by Hoffman. Nix can't grab it. Now Nix does have it. He's checked by Serville, but holds on to the ball. Nix will throw it up to Dan Williams. Williams is coming forward. He's got a lot of space to run. He's going to throw it over to Goodwin. Back to Williams, who shoots. The save. Oh, and it gets by Snyder, but he turns around and stops it just before
great,
the goal
great
line.
Great recovery by Snyder. It actually bounced over him, and he just grabbed it right as it was above the goal line.
Serville can't control the ball. He kicks it ahead of himself. He's being covered by Hoffman. We're going to have a call now. Holding.
McGill ball.
It is. Holding against Guelph. But how big a goal would that have been for Dan Williams?
Oh, it would have been huge.
Here comes McGill. Goodwin with the ball. They're down by three into the final minute here. He loses it. Gets stripped again. We're going to have a possession call, a procedure call. Holding. And it's Guelph ball. They're going to say Goodwin. And Goodwin drops his head to the turf and puts his hands over his head. He can't believe it. But it's Guelph possession. Curtis Knight will pick the ball up.
They're going to try to run out as much as the clock here. They've got a comfortable lead with this little time left.
Throw it over all the way to Snyder. He's got Goodwin heading after him. He's going to throw the pass up along the sideline. And there's Critch coming all the way back into his own end. He's going to go for a bit of a run. He's got some wheels. You don't often get to see it because of his deep attack position. But he shows some speed. Hayden Nix all over him trying to get that ball free. The double team comes now. Great job by Williams to knock it free.
Hayden Nix running up the field.
Nix with the pass up to McLean. McLean throws it ahead. There's a long pole going after DeLangley. 30-second clock is on the field. We're into the final moments of play.
Another save. Poor angle shot by Donovan.
You have no choice, though. He's got to take a shot as soon as he gets a chance. Shot almost picked off there. But Guelph will scoop it up. And this is going to be it. The Guelph Gryphons. Oh, and knocked out of play. It's going to be McGill ball. There just won't be enough time, though, I don't think. It looks like the Guelph Gryphons will be the 2013 Bagatoway Cup champions. McGill throws it up to Donovan. He can't catch the ball. It's knocked ahead.
Lost once again.
And there it is. They run off the bench. The game is over. 14-11. Guelph, 2013 Bagatoway champions.
2013 Kufla champions.
What a great game by these Guelph Gryphons. McGill running out to gather together, circle around Riley McGillis and give him some credit for the job he did. What a tough ending to the season for McGill, but what a great story for these Guelph Gryphons.
Three games in one weekend and three upsets. Three games that, based on statistics, they were expected to lose, and they came back.
Absolutely fantastic. We're going to give you our players of the game and tournament most valuable player as the presentations will be made. The player of the game for McGill was Connor Goodwin with a few goals. He had a couple goals in the second half, some assists, and had a very strong second half of the game. For Guelph, the player of the game with five goals, Brett Ulbicus. And what a game he had. Just a dominant force today. Our defensive player of the game overall is Ben Van Galen, number 44 from the Guelph Gryphons.
He was just phenomenal from start to finish.
Such a great job on Kevin Donovan and whoever else he was covering, winning faceoffs, doing everything in his own half of the field for the Guelph Gryphons. And the most valuable player of the 2013 Bagatoway Cup, which will be presented shortly, is Ryan Serville.
Oh, yeah.
And I'll tell you, he was great in every game he played.
Just such a creative, skillful player. Can put the net and put the ball in the net in a multitude of ways.
Are we shooting all this? The Bagatoway Cup is on the field. They've brought the table out. The medals are there. They'll be presented. And McGill has lined up. And now Connor Duchars runs over to his teammates who are still celebrating and says, guys, line up. We're going to go shake hands. Let's not make them wait. Classy move. These are two very classy schools, very classy teams. We saw a nice, clean, hard played but cleanly played game.
Great sportsmanship by both teams.
Yeah, and a great, great show of lacrosse. We talked earlier during the break about what a fantastic level of play Kufla is enjoying. And today's game, a great example of that. We saw amazing lacrosse on both sides. We are going. We're going to sign off for announcing, but we'll just keep the camera on to see the medals and the trophy presented. But congratulations to both teams. Congratulations to all six teams taking part in this tournament. We've seen some great lacrosse. It's been our pleasure to have you with us on the Streaming Sports Network. Thank you so much for being a part of it. I am Stephen Stamp for Ben Follows and the rest of the SSN crew. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks for watching.